Let us pray.
Father, we come before you today
and we're praying that we'll start in a better way to do the work you have committed into our hands in Jesus' name.
As we look into this renewal of consecration, speak to all our hearts so we'll be who we ought to be. In Jesus' name we pray. This time I do not intend to keep you for a long time, but I want you to understand that to renew consecration means that you were consecrated before, and perhaps now you are not as consecrated as before. And so it becomes necessary to renew that consecration. I look back to the days when I was very, very young. And those days have always helped me. I didn't live too much with my own parents because the place we lived did not have the facilities I needed to complete even my primary school. Because of that, I needed to live outside the family for a very long time, both during school days as well as during the holidays. I came out of primary school and I still needed to live with somebody else because I needed to start with modern school. I had not gone through secondary school. Because of that, I had to move again to another place. Then, after staying there a brief moment of time, I needed to go to another place where we will be well prepared for entrance exam. So I left the modern school and went to primary six. I'd finished, I'd even started modern school, but then I needed to go to that school because the teacher that had to coach me for the secondary school entrance exam was teaching at that time in that class. Eventually, I passed into secondary school, but for the rest of the year, I needed to live with that man so that I would still keep on learning. Then thereafter, I went to secondary school. And the system of work in the secondary school demanded commitment or consecration. We never called it consecration, obviously, because from the primary school level, the men I lived with, three of them, they were not married. And it demanded a lot from me. There was no pipe water where we were. So I had to go to the riverside and bring water for these three men to take their bath. I had to cook their breakfast for them. If I didn't cook it well, I got into trouble. If it was eba and it wasn't well cooked for those three people, that thing that was not well cooked was reserved until I will finish it at the normal level they would allow me to eat, because they are not going to waste that thing. So if I've done it in a wrong way, then I have to keep that thing, no refrigerator, for about 4 days. I had to be eating that thing. And of course, I had to prepare another one for them because there was no other person to prepare it for them. And we add to all these things we're talking about planning from early childhood, before I slept at night. Those three men have to take their bath in the morning. Therefore, I have to figure it out myself when I would need to wake up. Now, they didn't put priority on my education. They put priority on the fact that I was living with them. I had to take care of them, sweep the house, cook for them. It was my father that put priority on the education. Getting to my father, I would go there once in about 2 weeks. He would look at the cards. Now, he didn't know what I was going through with all these three men. If I didn't do well, he'll beat me very seriously over that weekend. Now, they were not very, very religious. My father was religious. If I went back during the weekend, fortnightly, and daddy rang bell 5:30 in the morning for morning devotion, I didn't get up because I'd been lazy where I was. I got into trouble. So I had to figure out my life, that with these people, I needed to do all I should do. When I leave them and go to my father, I must also do everything that I should do. Then the school work was there and the teachers were there. And some of the teachers were so difficult, I even remember their names now, you know, because of their very, very harsh and difficult. But in all that, I learned consecration and commitment. Then I went to Mayflower School. In Mayflower School, because we were the second set, the first set started in 1956. We came in 1957. When we came in, no dormitory. When we came in, we didn't have all the things that we needed. Therefore, our beds were put at the veranda of the classroom, all lined about. And they are double-decker. And the veranda is a little bit high. So if you fall from even the veranda, you can break your leg. If you fall from the double-decker bed to the veranda, then to the ground, you'll get to the hospital. So at that very young age, we were taught about discipline, about consecration, and about commitment. Again, early in the morning, because there was no water, we had to cross the road. And it was a major road leading from Lagos to Ijebode, and the vehicles were generally fast. So if you didn't want to die, even though you had to get 3 buckets of water in the morning, and the principal will stand there and will mark everybody, then you know that if you should get the water, yet the vehicles are going and coming, if you don't want to die, you watch the road. If you die, the principal will just write to your parents who are sorry an accident happened and this and that. So the school had nothing to lose. Therefore, you had to watch your life, watch the work you are doing, watch your studies as well. I remember quite well now some teachers that didn't stay long at school because we had co-educational school. And if teachers did anything with the girls in the school, that means that your appointment is terminated. The Western region that time could not say anything and say that our school will keep a teacher that had not even a moral affair, letter discovered in that student's letter, written by a teacher, the very next day you have gone. So from early childhood, I learned that if you committed sin, you lose your job. So now that when I now came to church, I got converted, they talked about backsliding. When you backslide, they get your name out of the book of life. I knew that. I knew that when you committed adultery or fornication, you got out of school the following day. Nothing will make you stay. And I remember the names of the teachers that didn't spend 3 years at school because of all those things that they did. Not only that, at school, we learned our normal lectures. But we were to build our dormitories where we will stay. Therefore, the block making machines were bought. And the employers in the school, those who are adults, they were not actually making the blocks. We were supposed to make the blocks and by number. So I knew about accountability on time as a little child, because all the Form 1 students, before this particular time, everyone must have carried these many blocks and then carried to another place where we're making the site. While we have the timetable from 8 o'clock in the morning till 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, from 8 to 9, 10 students will go out and be helping. That means you missed the algebra class. When those 10 people finish, then they brush up immediately and come to the class. The next 10 people will go and join the bricklayers. Because while the classroom work is going, the building is also going on. So at a very early age, we learned about hard work. Not only that, in our school, at the weekend, we had magazine. That magazine is to teach us on how to write articles. Now, those articles, when they are written, everybody must write. Then we have editor. We have assistant editor. We have pen man. So when we write all those articles, they might choose you for this week that you are the pen man. And so you must copy all the articles. Then the editors will get through everything. At the weekend, the principal will read through everything, correct all the English. Monday morning, we are at the assembly. He'll bring the magazine of class one out and then read everything, all the things that are wrong. That's the time we knew about libel. Because sometimes we wrote some articles that gave out a wrong information. We said we paid these school fees and this is what we're doing. We're doing all the building. I will read everything. Then at the assembly, he will analyze that article. He will say, when you pass out of school, if you write this article for Daily Times, then this is what they will do to you. He'll bring that student out so that you don't make this mistake later in life. You are beaten. The editor that wrote that article, if you did that in Daily Times, this is what they will do for you. That editor will go in for it. The penman is free because the penman is under the authority and the supervision of the editor. So we learned that there is supervision. And because that is the editor that, passed that article in, the person that wrote and the editor got into trouble. Then we knew that if anything is wrong in the Daily Times, they will not take the printers, they will take editor, they will take writer. We learned that at school. So when you have gone through all that system, very hard life, we hardly had holidays. Now, we had holidays, but then, remember that we had farm plantation, rice, garri, yam, and a lot of things, cassava, in the school farm. If everybody went on holidays, who will be taking care of these things during the holidays? How about the harvesting? So we would need volunteers among the student body. Apart from those volunteers, we who were teachers, because when I passed out in 1962, I became a teacher in the primary section. Some of us teachers will also have to wait during the holidays and supervise the students that volunteer to wait during the holidays. That has been life since I started schooling. But the point is this, when it comes to consecration, I've never seen consecration like I saw, and I'm still seeing in our school. Taishulani came here just to see the building, and then one of the guards told him that I'm around. I think he said he wasn't interested, he didn't want to see me, but he just came to see the building. But eventually I had the information, and then I went to see him, and I greeted him. I told him to come and sit down, but no. And he knew that I knew him, that his life is not a life of sitting down. His life is to wake up 5:30 in the morning, go through the drill with all the students there. He was in the Second World War before he came to establish Mayflower School. And all of us students, that is all that we went through. But the point I'm making is this. When I came out and I saw him, I greeted him. The man I saw with him was the headmaster of the primary section since 1965. 1987, he was still the headmaster. That's commitment. Then we went through the church. He wanted to see the building. They parked on the other side. And then when I got to the other side, I saw the driver, Demola. Demola had been there since 1960. He was still the driver, 1987. Then I met somebody and I said, do you remember Bayo? Because we taught together in 1982. And the person told me, Bayo is still there. Bayo was still a teacher there. I was, counseling. And somebody received card. And she came in. Oh, I said, Bridget, how are you? Oh, Bridget said, I'm fine. Now, in 1956, Bridget was a baby because Bridget is the daughter of our chief cook in Mayflower. And I saw her from the age of 2 to the age of 3 to the age of 6 as a little girl. I will walk to Ikene to primary school and come back and finish primary 6. And then after that, came into the secondary school. After that, she went to America. She did her degree. She had master's degree. The father had been the chief cook since 1956. They started that school. He was the chief cook when I was a student. When I became a teacher, he was still the chief cook. I went to university and came back. He was still the chief cook. I saw the daughter, Bridget, and Bridget is now a worker here in the Lagos church. I said, how is your daddy? Oh, he said, daddy is still in Mayflower. And I said, what does he do now? Well, just because he's now of age and, very, very aged. But then he's still supervising all that he was doing before. 1956 to 1987, 31 years, our chief cook is still there. And you work hard. And it is not that there is any reward in heaven. And this is commitment and consecration. If the people of the world can be this consecrated, here we are in the Christian fold. We had thought that we had consecrated, but now we need to renew our consecration. And even the people, were those bricklayers then? We know them because all of us students, we worked with them. We made the blocks together. We dug the foundations of all the dormitories together. We built our dormitories ourselves. We had carpentry society. We had horticultural society. We made all the flowers ourselves. And we made all those things ourselves. The electricity in the school, you would belong to either the barbing society or the art society or the horticultural society, apart from all that you are doing. Then after that, you go to the farm. And if you do not finish your assignment on the farm, the following day, 2 o'clock in the morning, Ty comes to your class and he says, Senior Prefect or Class Prefect, you didn't finish your job yesterday. Why? Now, he'll tell the teacher, I'm sorry, now you cannot continue with the subject. We went to the farm. Not that the teacher will pack his chalk and, duster and go to the staff room. He follows after us to go and supervise. And the money we received in those days, because he'll tell you he wasn't getting money. Sheila, the wife, wasn't getting money. And he will tell you that this is how he is. He put everything on the table. If you wanted to check his bank account, he says, this is it. And he's willing to serve this generation. So all the teachers, when he tells all the teachers that, I remember me after school sat and were teaching there, 10 pounds, 15 pounds. Now, those other cooks that I talked about, If those of us who passed out of school sat, if we're getting 10 pounds, those other people were lower. But then that means that we ate the same food. If the ogi was not well cooked, he would sit on the table and eat his own. If fly comes in, gets into your own food, and you bring it to Ty, you say, excuse me, sir, fly has gone into my food. Ty will say, bring it. Then he will give you his own. He will remove the fly and drink your ogi. And then therefore you will drink his own. And he had taught all the other teachers in the staff school that there should never be any riot in the school because of food. Therefore, I will eat. You teachers, whether the food is good or not, you won't die. You will eat. And his wife is European. And when you see a person having wife, European wife, eating that ogi with us, and when the akara is not well cooked, he will eat it with us. When there is fly, he removes it, and then he eats it and gives you his own plate. How can you riot? That's why they are consecrated. Now here we are today as Christians. We are working for the kingdom of God. And it's a lot to do. Maybe you have not worked for 4 years yet in the church and you are tired. I've talked to you about people that have no grace, no Bible, no Holy Ghost, no doctrine. 20 years have passed, they're still there. And when you leave, they pity you. I mean, if you're teaching in Mayflower and you left, it's like you are backsliding. It's like you don't have love for humanity. It's like you are a criminal. Even though we don't say it, but you'll be wondering that how could you leave? The policies of the school is the best you can get anywhere because those people that live in, we used to say that we are better than King's College because they spoon feed them, but we live a life of self-reliance. You build everything yourself, that's life. But then when they build everything for you with government money, we would even say that if they gave you, you should reject it because it will not develop you to manhood. You will not be a real human being. And once in a while, every time, from the youngest to the highest, we did marathon because we'll go from Ikene and go on the way to Ijebude, branch to Ilishan. Before you get to Irolu, you come back to Ikene, it's cross-country. It's round like that, many, many kilometers, and tie himself with his stick. He will be running after us. Everybody will do it until you come. There were times we did it and we collapsed. They will pour water on us, we'll get up again. Because no vehicle will carry you. A particular day in the term is a day of self-reliance. When every one of us, that day there will be no cooking at school. Now you go to the farm. If you see palm kernels, you'll take it. If you see cassava, you can roast it. Anything you see, you can get. All through that day is a day of self-discipline and self-reliance. Nobody will cook for you. Now, what do you do? And so in life, when I now became a Christian, and you know, that time from school start, I had to study for my A-level. And you can't say you are studying for A-level, and because of that, not teach all your classes, not go to prep, and also not go to the evening supervision, and not do everything that had to be done. So I don't remember 1962-63, I don't remember ever sleeping before 1 a.m. because I had to prepare for my exam. And only in the night can you do that. And eventually I passed, I went. When I went, he said, the school will train me. So I went to university. Now I was born again. But do you know that when I was born again, what they have taught us about accountability, that now you shouldn't ever get anything free. Because Nigeria, people are cheap. They want cheap things. Never get anything free. If you get anything free, you are not living right. It was like you are committing sin. And we had been taught that all over. And so when they sponsored me, I was to come back and spend 5 years. Even though I was born again. When I came back and the university gave me scholarship to come and read PhD, I couldn't go. The 5 years, I wanted to serve them. Ty released me and he said, you can go, but I couldn't go. Because in your mind, you know you shouldn't get anything free. And I was a Christian then. And I sat 5 years before I now left. So when I became a Christian and at the church, they would call everybody to come and carry something. That was my life. I didn't even know it was a special type of a church program. I thought everybody ought to be doing that. We built our dormitories in, you know, the secondary school. Why don't we build our church ourselves now that we came to church? For me, it was normal. And when we came, that our own church overseer will also carry shovel and carry something. I didn't see that he was consecrating too much, because that's what our principal Tashulami did at school, that he will work with the students. So if general overseer is now working with members of the church, that's the normal thing. If he didn't, to me, that would be the strange thing. When I saw all those Sunday school teachers that they were at Antony here, the Apostolic Faith, we took cutlasses with Sunday school teachers and our pastors and overseer himself, and were cutting the road to make that road to the church over there. For me, that was the normal thing. I didn't feel that anybody should complain, because in secondary school, that's what we were doing, even as unbelievers. So to do it now in the church, I didn't even know it was consecration, because now we had got to the level that before I will call anything consecration, it may mean that they stone me and I die, and then I rise up again to do the work, I will count that as consecration. And the church that I grew up in, the overseer happened to be a person that will talk about the second coming, about being born again, about you doing something, and make use of the politicians that will be eating fried plantain. And for this kingdom of the world, they would do this and do that. When he said that to me, that was normal. And when all the other people will spend 2 hours praying on the altar to consecrate, I didn't see what they were telling the Lord. I just went on my knees. 5 minutes, I said, Lord, it's all for you. What do you want me to do? If you want me to die, here am I, O Lord. I said that in 5 minutes, I got off my knees. All the other people are still consecrating for 2 hours. I didn't know what they were consecrating. Because you know, even after that consecration of praying for 2 hours, for me, they were not doing anything. But I just went there 5 minutes, remembering what I was in the secondary school without a Christian. I just said, Lord, everything for you. If you want me to die, amen. And so we must understand that even in the world, people are consecrating. And here comes to our own time to consecrate. If we have consecrated before, we need to renew that consecration. And understand that there are people that have been working for years with Billy Graham. When we went to Billy Graham Center in Wheaton, Illinois, they built a particular hall and they named it after a particular man. And I asked, why did they do that? Oh, they said, this man had been working with Billy Graham since 1947. The work he was doing in 1947 is what he's still doing in 1987, 40 years. He could preach, but he's not preaching. Because I've listened to him preach before, whenever Billy Graham was not able to have the radio ministry or the radio program, this man would just replace him and preach. That man, in fact, I thought that this man can preach more than Billy Graham. Really. But then his assignment in Billy Graham Evangelical Association is not preaching. His assignment is another thing. That's what he has been doing since 1947 to 1987. While we were there on their ground, I thought about it myself, that these people don't emphasize sanctification, Holy Ghost baptism, Pentecostalism. All they know is that receive the Lord, be born again. And if a man on the basis of being born again only can stay from 47 to 87 doing the same assignment, What am I calling consecration? What am I doing? And what are we doing? So we need to understand what consecration is all about. As I've said, I don't intend to keep you, but I'll read a passage to you, a passage or two. Mark chapter 10, from verse 28. Then Peter began to say unto him, Lo, we have left all and have followed thee. We have left all and have followed thee. John chapter 21, verse 3. Simon Peter said unto them, I go a fishing. They say unto him, We also go with thee. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately, and that night they caught nothing. Peter had left all for more than 3 years, and he told the Lord, Lord, we have left all. This is consecration. But then Jesus died and rose from the dead, and in less than 40 days after Jesus had left them, Peter had said, I go a fishing. I have a wife. I have a family. Even if I will say I will go hungry, how about my wife? How about my mother-in-law? How about all these other people? I don't know about you, but I'm going a fishing. And other people too, like John the Beloved, like James, like all the others, they said, Well, Peter, we didn't know you were thinking like that. We also have been thinking like that. We go too. And they went. And that whole night, they caught nothing. The question is it a new net or the old net? Was the old net burnt so that we know that this is for life? Because if there is no net, how do we go fishing again? If it's a new net, where did you get the money now? Is it the money of the Lord that remained, that Judas had not finished spending before he left, that you took now to buy a new net? Whether it was old net or new net, they went to the riverside that night, they caught nothing. No man can prosper outside God's will. Other people may do it. Those who are not as intelligent as us may do it, but no man can prosper outside God's will. And then Jesus came to them, to cut a long story short, verse 15. So when they had dined, Jesus saith unto Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than this? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my lambs. Jesus called him back to a renewal of his consecration, and he wanted him to have the same commitment as he had before. Do you still love me? More than all these things. Lord, you know I love you. Then if you do, start all over again. You forsook it all before. Forsake it yet now. And follow after me and feed my lambs. The Lord is asking us. Because as we grow older, circumstances may warrant people asking us questions. Now you didn't marry before, so you must understand that those consecrations before you were married, that's different. Now you are married. Now you have children. Think about your life. Or is it what you are going to do for the rest of your life till you grow old, till Jesus comes? Think about it. And because of that, we might say, I'm not backsliding, but I have to go a fishing. I have to help myself. I have to do this, I have to do that. But remember, prosperity will be far away outside God's will. Happiness, peace, joy, satisfaction will be far away if we're outside God's will. We must still answer the question, lovest thou me more than these? May God help every one of us to answer, yes, Lord, thou knowest I love thee. Let's rise up and pray. Yes, Lord, thou knowest I love thee.